Valley West.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's a great honor to be here today as we consider in this House the first bill that is coming to us from the Senate, and I'm very proud to be its sponsor. This bill was first introduced by Senator James Cowan and has already received unanimous consent, unanimous support in the other place. And today I hope to convince members of this chamber to give it the same enthusiastic support in this House and thus change the lives of millions of Canadians. Genes are the building blocks of our lives. They tell us who we are and where we come from, our inherited strengths and our susceptibilities. Our genetic makeup more fundamental than our ethnicity, our gender, our race, or even our sexual orientation. It's the foundation of who we are as human beings. And since the discovery of the human genome, we know that our genetic codes contain information that can prevent illness, thwart disease, improve, or even save lives. The late U.S. Senator Ted Kennedy observed that discovery of the human genome would affect the 21st century as profoundly as the splitting of the atom or the invention of the computer in the 20th century. When Senator Cowan first introduced this bill in 2013, there were only 2,000 genetic tests available. Now today, after 3.5 years, there are more than 48,000 genetic tests for diseases like Huntington's disease, early onset Alzheimer's. There are tests for genes associated with ALS, kidney disease, breast and ovarian cancer, and certain forms of colon cancer. And the list is growing at a truly exponential rate. Canadian scientists have last year discovered the gene that is associated with cystic fibrosis. And just this summer, researchers have found the gene associated with metastatic, fast-moving prostate cancer, explaining why with some men prostate cancer moves slowly and others it advances very quickly, perhaps informing treatment or helping with people determine their options. This probably explains why my father lived for over 20 years with prostate cancer, and yet some of his friends died after only 18 months. Canadian healthcare institutions conduct tens of thousands of these tests each year, and the information gleaned from them allows Canadian researchers and physicians to diagnose diseases, guide treatment, inform reproductive planning, and warn of adverse drug reactions. They're also used for clinical trials by innovative pharmaceutical and biotech companies to find new treatments for old diseases. In most cases, having a genetic makeup doesn't mean that a person will automatically or even necessarily develop a disease or condition, only that one might. But knowledge is power, and this opens up the possibility of taking concrete steps to reduce the possibility or the chance that a disease or a condition will actually develop in the first place. Now, perhaps the most famous example of this is actor Angelina Jolie. You will probably know that her mother died of cancer, and when she looked at that, she decided to undergo the test and determined that indeed she was a carrier for the BRCA1 gene. Women with this genetic mutation have as high as 87% chance of developing breast cancer and as high as 60% chance of developing ovarian cancer. Ms. Jolie opted to have preventative surgery and reduced her chance of getting breast cancer from 87% down to 5% and reduced her chance of getting ovarian cancer by some 98%. She wrote in the New York Times, and I quote, "I can tell my children that they don't need to fear that they will lose me to breast cancer." The benefits of genetic knowledge should be not limited, though, to celebrities, but every one of us in this House may want to undertake a genetic test at some point. Famous or not, none of us should be denied access to a genetic test, and none of us should be afraid of having a genetic test for fear of discrimination. In the course of working on this piece of legislation with Senator Cowan, I came to know the story of a young man who was only 24 years old, who had family members who had tested positive for Huntington's disease. Given that kind of family history, he had to weigh out his options about whether or not he should actually have the test to see if he carried the same genetic makeup. He took the very difficult decision to have that test, and he shared that decision with his employer. On a Friday, he found out he had tested positive and indeed had the gene. His employer asked him what the results were, and he was honest, and he told him. The Monday following, he went to work, and he was fired. He was a video editor. His employer was afraid, for some reason, for his equipment. Of course, this young man did not have the disease, does not have the disease, and will likely not develop any symptoms for this disease for maybe as many as 20 years. And Huntington's is an area of huge research right now. There are clinical trials going on right now for drugs which will perhaps delay the onset even further. But he is being discriminated against now for disease he might never have if medical science works the way it should. This bill is inspired by the belief that all Canadians should profit from the advances in genetic science. And to achieve this goal, the Genetic Non-Discrimination Act seeks to ensure that the knowledge that we have through genetic research is protected from potential abuse and that there are as few impediments as possible to going and getting a test. In Canada, unlike most Western countries, if one has a genetic test, there's no protection from a third party using that information, those test results, and perhaps to one's detriment. This is the problem of genetic discrimination, and that's what Bill 201, S-201, seeks to address. Genetic discrimination can take many forms. As in that first story, it can take the form of employment termination, denial of a promotion, denial of child custody, and there are cases of this, increase in insurance premiums, or even cancellation of an insurance policy. Each one of these is a heartbreaking story. Now, Dr. Ronald Cohen is a clinical geneticist, now pediatrician-in-chief at SickKids Hospital in Toronto. And he testified in the Senate about parents feeling they had to refuse genetic testing, even though that could point the best way to treatment or care, for fear that their child, who may be sick, could face future discrimination. He spoke of parents who had spent years searching for a diagnosis who broke down in tears as they had to decline genetic testing because of concerns over genetic discrimination. He described one young patient whose symptoms were consistent with two different diseases, and the only way to promote that diagnosis and get the right treatment was to actually have a genetic test. But the parents felt unable to consent for fear of discrimination. Dr. Cohen told senators that without the test, he could not properly care for that young girl. Without legislative protection, her parents could not agree to have the test. And this is no choice, no decision a parent should ever have to make. Canada is one of the few industrialized countries in the world without some sort of legislative protection for its citizens' genetic information. Our laws lag behind Austria, Belgium, Bulgaria, Denmark, Finland, France, Germany, the Netherlands, Norway, Portugal, and Spain. The United States has had this sort of anti-discrimination in place for over 13 years with the Federal Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act. 24 American states have passed additional legislation limiting the use of genetic information by life, disability, and long-term care insurers. Renowned, award-winning genetic researchers with international experience are expanding the reach of precision or personalized or targeted medicine so that the future of medical care is rapidly changing. There is no more significant advancement in anything medical that we've had since the discovery of the human genome. And without protection, Canadians will not benefit from these huge advances in medical science. This affects our health and the health of every Canadian that we are here to serve. It affects the future of medical science in this country. Personalized or targeted medicine is the future of medicine, and Canadians deserve protection to ensure that they get the best care and so that we don't waste health dollars and make sure that we have the best public and personal health. Now, S-301 I call a three-legged stool. Each piece of the legislation is crucial to fighting discrimination. They are in order of importance the proposed new Genetic Non-Discrimination Act, or what I'm now calling the GNA, to fight discrimination against RNA or DNA, then the amendments to the Canadian Labour Code, and finally amendments to the Canadian Human Rights Act. Each part is essential, and this bill cannot be arbitrarily disseminated, disassembled, any more than a stool, if it loses a leg or tool, will be able to support us and our weight. Principally, and the very first thing, is this bill will create a new Genetic Non-Discrimination Act, GNA, with three new criminal offences. It would prohibit requiring anyone to undergo a genetic test, to disclose those results of a genetic test as a condition of providing goods or services, or it would also prohibit the collection, use, or disclosure of the results of genetic testing without the person's consent. Of course, there are exemptions for medical practitioners or for research. To my mind, this is not controversial. None of these prohibitions are controversial, and they are urgently needed. The new Genetic Non-Discrimination Act is the single most important part of this bill. The GNA is necessary to fight DNA or RNA discrimination. It states clearly and unequivocally that the society condemns genetic discrimination and its unacceptable behavior, and it will not be tolerated. The criminal sanctions are set high to serve as an effective deterrent. The bill doesn't target sectors or industry. It targets bad behavior. It names the bad behavior and ensures that there are laws to protect people against those behaviors. That's our job as federal legislators to put into place laws that will protect Canadians, and we have the criminal law power to do that work. That criminal law will state what is unacceptable conduct and then prohibit that conduct. That is what Canadians expect us to do on their behalf. Secondly, Bill S-201 amends the Canada Labour Code with a set of amendments providing a complaint procedure for employees in federally regulated workplaces who encountered genetic discrimination. I know this number is not large, but nonetheless they are important, and this could serve as a model for other jurisdictions. And lastly, there's a set of amendments that adds genetic characteristics as a prohibited ground of discrimination under the Canadian Human Rights Act. A three-legged stool with an act, with criminal penalties, changes to the Labour Code, and changes to the Human Rights Act, holding us up as a robust piece of legislation that will protect our rights as Canadians and ensure the best health of Canadians. It's interesting that I have heard that there is some sense that we shouldn't have a standalone act, but it is fine to simply put this into Canadian Human Rights Act. Peter Engelman, a labour lawyer and human rights advocate, former counsel to the Canadian Human Rights Commission, told senators why, in his opinion, the specific protections as proposed in the Genetic Non-Discrimination Act are critical, and why just amending the Human Rights Act alone is not sufficient. The reality is the way human rights legislation works is it's reactive instead of proactive. It puts the burden or the onus on the complainant. They bear the costs, they bear the burden and the stress of taking a complaint forward, which is after the fact, not before the fact. There are not significant deterrents in it, and it places, sometimes people are very vulnerable in difficult positions that they should not have to be. What the Act does is it ensures that we have together one act that will make it a crime against Her Majesty, against the state, and thus make sure that we have the adequate protection to do that.
1 minute.
Senator Cowan presented an earlier incarnation of this bill and tested constitutionality, and the Senate has deemed indeed that we do have the federal power to enact this sort of legislation to ensure that Canadians are protected. Law professors, experts will disagree. Essentially, I am hoping that the Standing Committee on Justice and Human Rights will examine that thoroughly, and I am convinced they will find that we do have the federal authority, the federal power, as we do in other areas of legislation, to enact this sort of bill. federal government has that power in securities, has it in tobacco marketing and other things under so-called provincial jurisdiction. However, we believe that this is the right thing for the federal government to do. Canada is behind. Canada needs to step up to the plate. Canada needs to do this now. We're behind and we need to act. This is our chance as legislators to bring better health to Canadians and ensure that Canadians have access to genetic tests. We, this day, will be able to save lives. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.